Dad, can I play matching game?
Of course you can. Here you go.
Yay! What's this?
In matching game you have a bunch of cards with two of each kind and your goal is to find the matching ones. But what if there would be QR codes in the cards instead of these images? To make that happen, let's create the game first, which shouldn't be so hard. First we need cards. A card can have three states: covered if the image is facing downwards, uncovered if it's facing upwards, and paired if we already found its pair. We can click on each card to flip it over. If we flipped over a second card, we have to check if those have the same images. If yes, then remove them from the table, if not, just flip them back. The game ends when we paired all cards. Or when we give up. At first I tried to make the game three-dimensional, but there was a problem that I couldn't solve. I created the cards and placed some sprite renderers on top and bottom of them to display the images, but the images were so blurry that if I would replace those with actual QR codes, they would be indistinguishable for sure. So I switched to 2D and I used UI components, which way I could make it work nicely, even the animations aren't too bad. Now we have the game, so time to replace these placeholder images with actual QR codes. For that I need to write a QR code generator, so first let's dive deep into their behavior. This is a QR code. It consists of black and white squares, which are called modules. There are 40 different versions of QR codes that differ in their size. The smallest, version 1, is 21 by 21 module, which can store up to 17 bytes, so 17 characters. The largest, version 40, is 177 by 177 module, which can store up to 2953 bytes, or 7089 numbers in numeric mode. QR codes use error correction, so if a part of the QR code is damaged or missing, we still can reconstruct the data with the help of the error correction bits. We can choose between different error correction levels. The higher the error correction level, the less data we can store in the QR code because we need more error correction bits. It's time to check out how the data is encoded into a QR code and how can we read it. Each QR code has three of these big squares in the two top and the left bottom corner, which are called finder patterns. They are used to determine the orientation of the QR code, so QR code readers can rotate them into the original position even if we scan it upside down. Bigger QR codes from version 2 have one or more alignment patterns that look very similar to the finder patterns. Then we have timing patterns, which are just alternating black and white modules between the finder patterns. The next special area is this, and it's copied to here as well. The first two bits describe the error correction level, which can be one of these. You can see that with the highest error correction level, we can still get back the original text even if 30% of the data is damaged. The next three bits describe the mask pattern, which can be one of these. The mask will be overlaid to the QR code and it changes some modules. So if the mask contains a black module in a given position, the module in the QR code should be changed in that position. So for example, if we use this mask, we invert every other row of the QR code. Some parts of the QR code aren't affected by the mask, where we store the format information and other patterns like the finder or alignment patterns. So before we can decode the message, let's apply the mask. It's black, black, white, so we should use this mask. And here we go. Now we can read the encoded message. The data always starts in the bottom right corner and we read it in a zigzag pattern, so we read two columns at a time. First the right one, then the left one, and then move one row up. The black modules represent 1 and the white modules represent 0. After we reach the top, we have to move to the previous two columns. Remember that this row contains formatting information, so we should skip this and also all other special modules like finder patterns, alignment patterns, and so on. So we read the next two columns, but this time from top to bottom with the same zigzag pattern. Now we know how to read the bits, so let's decode this QR code. The first four bits will tell us the encoding mode, which can be one of these. In numeric mode we can only store numbers, in alphanumeric mode we can store numbers, uppercase letters and some other symbols, and in byte mode we can store characters from the ISO 88591 char set, which contains ASCII characters and these characters right here as well, so it contains the most important characters and symbols. Based on the encoding mode we have to interpret the bits differently. This QR code is in byte mode as you can see, which is the easiest one because every character will be encoded with 8 bits, so 8 modules. The next 8 bits will tell us the length of the message, so how many characters have been encoded. We write down the bits in the right order and then convert it to decimal. It's 0000 1110, so it's 8 plus 4 plus 2, which means our message is 14 characters long. Then each character is represented by 8 modules. We write down the bits as before and convert the result to decimal. Then we look it up in the ISO 88591 character table. Our number is 76, so this will be the uppercase letter L. Then we continue with the next character with paying attention to the zigzag pattern, so we have 0110 1001, which is 105, so it's the letter I. Then we have 107, so letter K, 101, so letter E, 32, so a space, and so on. Oh, and it seems this QR code reminds us to like the video if we enjoyed it so far. It's really nice of it. Let's make its wish come true, as Christmas also coming. At the end of the message, there is a terminator sequence that contains 4 zeros. After that, the error correction bits come. Huh, that wasn't easy. Now let's see how I made my QR code generator, so how the encoding works. My generator works with version 1 QR codes with byte encoding mode and low error correction level. These are the smallest ones, so they will be readable on the small cards. And of course these are the easiest ones. We begin with creating the data bits. This will be a string that contains zeros and ones in it, so we can fill the QR code's data section with these bits. We start with the mode indicator, then the length of the message, and lastly the characters themselves. Each character takes up 8 bits as we've seen while decoding the code. Then close up with the terminator, so the 4 zeros. For a version 1 QR code we need 19 code words, which is 19 times 8, so 152 bits in total. If our message contains fewer bits, we should pad it with these bits right here until we reach 152. Once we have a 152 bit long message, we have to generate the error correction bits based on that. QR codes use read-Solomon error correction, which is the easiest thing in the world, so I won't explain it in detail because it's so trivial. Not because I don't understand what it's about and what am I doing. To understand this, we need a lot of hardcore maths. We will do our calculations in Galois field 2 to the power of 8, or also called GF256. This is a finite field that contains 256 elements, so 0, 1, 2, and so on, 255. These numbers can be represented by 8 bits, and because the mathematical operations are cyclical in GF256, the result of every calculation can be stored in a byte. If we want to multiply two numbers that have the same base, we just have to add the exponents together. For example, 2 to the power of 3 times 2 to the power of 7 is equals to 2 to the power of 10. To take advantage of this, we have to write every number as a power of 2, but in GF256 this can be done. We can generate these at the beginning and store them to get the log and anti-log table, so we don't have to calculate those every time. So 2 to the power of 0 equals 1. 2 to the power of 1 equals 2 times 1, so 2. 2 to the power of 2 equals 2 times 2, so 4. 2 to the power of 3 equals 2 times 4, so 8. And so on. The first interesting point comes when we reach 2 to the power of 8, which is 2 times 128, so 256, but remember, we are in GF256, so we have only numbers from 0 to 255, so we have to restrict this value to this interval. In GF256, we do this by XORing the value with 285, so this will become 29. Next we have 2 times 29, which is 58, then 116, and so on. Each time the result is bigger than 255, we do the XORing by 285. To get the error correction bytes, we have to do a bunch of polynomial long divisions. We convert the message string into a message polynomial, and we have to divide that with another polynomial called generator polynomial, which for example can be calculated by this formula. After doing enough steps, we get the error correction bits, which have to be written after the original message string. If I've used a larger version of QR code, I would need further steps, but for version 1, we are done. Now let's place the data in the matrix. I've explained this step already when we checked out how to decode the QR code. In the first step, I placed the special areas like finder patterns and then the message bits using the zigzag pattern explained before. Remember, this column and this row contain some special information like the error correction level and mask. We also have to calculate some error correction bits based on those, but this is practically the same algorithm as we use for the message. The only thing left here is the masking. We have to decide which mask has to be applied. We do the masking for the QR code scanner to be able to decode the code more easily by avoiding big white and black blocks and parts of the QR code similar to the finder patterns. So technically we could use any of them, but let's see how to calculate which is the best one. For this we will try out each 8 mask patterns and count the penalty score for each one. The mask with the lowest penalty score wins. The penalty score consists of 4 parts, each penalizes different things. The first part checks the code row by row and column by column. If we find more than 4 modules with the same color that are next to each other, we add some penalties. The second part checks if there are big blocks at least 2x2 of the same color and gives a penalty for them. The third part checks if parts of the QR code looks like the finder pattern and give a big penalty for them. We basically search for these two sequences. The last part checks if the amount of the white blocks is nearly the same as the amount of the black blocks. If not, we give a penalty based on that. After we calculated the 4 penalties, we add them up to get the final penalty for that mask. We do the same for each mask and select the best out of them. After that, we just have to apply the selected mask to the code and we are finished with this easy process of generating a QR code. I put some links I used in the description right below the like button if you are interested deeper in this topic. But we are not finished yet, since I still want to make a game with this QR code, so I needed some more things to do. I made some levels, each has a different word set. In the beginning we choose some words from the word set and generate the corresponding QR codes, place them on the cards and lastly shuffle the cards, so now we can play as they were normal images. I also made a level editor, so if you want you can create your own set of words and the game will choose from those words. At this point the game looks a bit strange, so I decided to change the look of it by using black and white colors everywhere, like in the QR codes. And it turned out not that bad. Try out the game on itch and tell me in the comments what do you think about your new favorite game.
This is your new favorite game.
Can you beat the hardest level? If you choose not to play this game, for some reason, I recommend checking out this video right here instead. This is an interactive devlog where you decide how the devlog continues, so based on your decisions you get a completely different experience than others, so definitely worth a try.